जी
अस्सलाम वालेकुम ऑनरेबल रिस्पेक्टिव टीचर्स एंड सीनियर एंड जूनियर कॉलीग्स आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन टुडेज सेशन टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू ब्रिंग ऑन स्टेज ऑल दोज पर्संस हु आर एक्चुअली ऑलवेज वर्किंग बिहाइंड द स्टेज फॉर अस एंड टू इन द स्टेज ऑल्सो वी हैव eminent cardiologists, both from all generations, to make this program more attractive. First of all, I would like to introduce our panelists for the day. Unfortunately, three of our panelists, Professor Fazlur Rahman sir, Professor Abdul Wadud sir, and Dr. Mohsin Ahmed, is unable to join us right from the beginning. But as they are in a as a matter, they are in a national duty, so they will join us as soon as they are free from there. And we have with us Dr. Professor M. G. Azam, Professor of Cardiology from NICVD. He is also the Scientific Secretary of Bangladesh Society of Cardiac Intervention and Publication Secretary of Cardiac Society of Bangladesh. He is the national organizer and course coordinator for SCAI in Bangladesh. We have with us Professor Amol Kumar Choudhury. He is also the course director. He is a professor of cardiology at National Institute of Cardiovascular Disease. He is the secretary of academic council of that institution. He has a course. He runs a course, and the course is called Bangladesh Cardiovascular Intervention Course. He is the executive member of Bangladesh Cardiac Society and treasurer of Bangladesh Society of Cardiac Intervention. We have with us in the panel Professor M. Badiuzzaman, a very senior interventionist. Not only that, he is one of the highest volume operators of Bangladesh. And last but not the least, I would like to introduce our chairperson for today, Professor Fazila Malik. She is the chief consultant cardiologist of National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute. This is only a small part of her designation. Her real strength lies on her capability of trained interventionists. She has trained so many of us that almost all institutions of Bangladesh has now interventional cardiology working who has trained under her. She's also carrying on her the large burden of complex PCI in Bangladesh, and she is also carrying our national flag to almost all international meetings as faculty. To add to her crown, she has been nominated as a member of the advisory body of Journal of Indian Medical Association just last year. So first of all, I would like to request Professor Fazila Madam to give a few opening remarks, then we shall start our program.
Right, so I'm audible now. So thank you, Taufik. That was very kind of you, very kind words, and I really truly appreciate and am humbled by your words. Thank you so much for being so kind in your praise. Well, today we have a very exciting session, and I'm really looking forward to this session because I think I'll be learning a lot from this session, because as Taufik was saying, that we want to see intervention from a nurse's and a technician's perspective, because to do a proper job, it's crucial that we have a proper teamwork, and the teamwork obviously consists of all of us, and a cath lab nurse and a cath lab technician play such a vital and such an important role for the success of a procedure. And today we will be highlighting that. And this series of lectures given by three speakers will not only teach us different aspects of coronary intervention, but also I think it will be of immense value for those of us who are starting their career in intervention, whether it's a cath lab nurse, a cath lab technician, or interventional cardiologist who's just embarking in interventional cardiology, or a cardiac fellow. And I would like to thank our guest speaker for India. We really appreciate the fact that you have given your time and have kindly consented to come to us, to our session. Thank you so much. And I hope that this is a beginning of friendship and relationship with Heart Foundation, and you will be attending many such programs in the future. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining us, and we will start our session now. Thank you.
So our first speaker is going to be Mr. N. Balasubramani. He is the senior cath lab technician and cath lab in charge of Apollo Gleneagles Hospital from Kolkata. He has been working as cath lab technologist since 2000. And to add to that, he also has a postgraduate diploma in hospital management. So I would like to welcome Mr. N. Balasubramani for his lecture, which is a very important step for every fellow and all technologists. That is, a good angiogram is the first step for good intervention. Mr. Balasubramani.
Thank you, Fazila ma'am, and the respected teachers for the kind words and introduction. I am Mr. Balasubramani from Kolkata. I am here to present on good angiogram is the first step for good intervention. And I am thanking you once again for giving me this opportunity. And dear colleagues, this is the presentation for us and for our guys. I just want to share my experience and some of the tips which we can utilize during our procedures. Yes. Angiography is generally done to visualize the vascular structures. It may be vein, it may be arteries. So it's mostly about vascular structure, studying the vascular structure. But it has been performed for different reasons. Maybe it's maybe for an injury, it may be for rupture, it may be for aneurysm, it may be for blockages. So for various reasons, it's been performed. And angiography guided intervention is done for the different part of body as well. Like it may be done in a cerebral area, it may be in a lower limbs or upper limbs or heart. And we in cath lab mostly, particularly in cardiac cath lab, we mostly handle with the cardiac procedures, particularly coronary intervention. And it has been considered gold standard still, I would say that, because there may be some different opinions, but still it has been considered as one of the gold standard procedures. And since we are living in a period, we are working in a period where coronary angiography is mainly done for interventions. You know, if you see about one or two decades before, the angiogram is mainly done for vascular revascularization, particularly for coronary bypass surgery, not for interventions. But after the drug-eluting stent, the scenario has completely changed. Today, we do mostly for coronary interventions. The bypass surgery is done in very few cases where it has been first considered as a first choice procedure, whereas most of the time it is the coronary intervention angioplasty as a first choice procedures. Our goal of coronary angiography, I am not going into all the interventions, because when I talk about angiography for interventions, it can be for peripheral, it can be for cerebral, it can be for any other procedure, maybe aortic interventions, aneurysm interventions, ruptures interventions. So it's a vast area. But today we would be discussing about goal of angiography, particularly for coronary regions. Our main goal of coronary angiography today, as we live in interventional era, establish the relationship for coronary ostium of, just a second. This one is minimized. Yeah. Establish the coronary ostium to the aorta for guide cath selection, because the intervention, the major tool is guide catheter. So to see the ostial relationship with the aorta is very important to delineate that properly. Then it comes to the target vessel, the pathway and angle of entry. Many of the time, the wire entry from the left main artery to the LAD or LCX being very difficult because the angle was not well delineated, or because of the bad tortuosity. Even in RCA, initial tortuosity, initial uptake of angle, or the calcification at the ostium, or calcification in the proximal segment, the angle between the branches in the proximal artery. These are very important and very well to be delineated. And when it comes to the lesion, it depends on the kind of lesion we treat with, the whether it is a discrete lesion, whether a long segment lesion, whether it's calcified lesion, whether the lesion is tandem lesions, and whether the lesion is well delineated, eccentricity of the lesion, particularly speaking. Many a times we assume the lesion is having openings in the other side, but when we see in multiple angles, we come to know that the eccentricity of the lesion. So it is very important to delineate the lesion very well. And then when it comes to side branch, it's when you handle lesions in side branch, particularly lesions with side branches, lesions with calcium, lesions in the ostium, these are lesions which comes with more restenosis. These are lesions will give surprises during our interventions. So it's very important to delineate the side branches well, and the side branch involvement, side branch ostial lesions, amount of plaque volume in the ostiums or in the lesion site. And then, for example, when it comes to talk about today, we do most of the stenters started doing retrograde procedures. So it's very important to well delineate the collateral supply. So showing the collateral supply, which branch has the connections. Many a times we go for the retrograde approach, we find the collateral we thought did not have any connection with the artery we want, the target vessel. So it's very important to see the collateral vessel very well. Collateral supply is very well. And most of the time the arteries are fine, but when very few occasions we find the arteries are going into spasm very frequently. So in those patients, it's better to vasodilate the artery. Many operators I have seen, Dr. Matthews and other operators, they do give GTN before doing angiogram also, 100 micrograms before angiogram GTN, and then followed by angiogram to delineate the artery well. SAR usually doesn't give contrast. After GTN, he starts the CINI and then gives contrast. Many a times SAR says that the contrast sticking to the wall many a times mislead us from the calcium and the contrast stasis. So it's better to start with the CINI and then do the injections like that. So GTN is very frequently used in many centers. And at the end, the minimal radiation, which we all want to do the every procedure. I'll start with left main coronary artery. Usually in a horizontal heart, it's a short left main. In vertical hearts, most of the times we find a bit long left main. These are usual things, but in unusual circumstances, we can see in a horizontal heart also a long left main. But usually this is the case we see. In general for surgery, if a planned surgery or a patient which has gone for angiogram before, or we plan for surgery if it is a diffuse disease, two views are more than enough to do the surgery. Aryocaudal in vertical heart followed by epicranial, and in horizontal, epicaudal in vertical heart, and I'm just mixing it up. Aryocaudal in vertical heart and the epicaudal in horizontal heart, and the epicranial in both the heart to see the distal arteries. To see the body of the left main, it generally we better see that in aryocaudal and aryocranial. In some situations in epicaudal, most of the time elevator views, particularly in spider and the aryocranial, the left main and proximal LAD part is slightly foreshortened. So it is better not to see the left main in these views. See, I am not going into routine views since we are based on interventions. Where do we want to see? I am just focusing on those areas and then telling you the views accordingly. When it comes to distal LMCA, LAO caudal in a shorter left main or horizontal heart will do. But when it comes to vertical heart, LAO caudal will show a foreshortened distal left main. In those situations, RAO cranial and RAO caudal will show the distal left main well. Ostial lesions, LAO caudal, as we call it's as spider, and AP caudal. RAO and LAO cranial, many a times when you do stained position in interventions, we still prefer cranial views. Many people will think in left main, ostium, doing a caudal view and spider view is the most preferential, but many a time spider view misguides us in stent positioning. So we prefer to do cranial views. Here you can see the horizontal heart on the left side, the vertical heart in this side. You can see that distal left main is well foreshortened in the right-sided picture. The horizontal heart one is not foreshortened in the distal left main, but still the RAO caudal well delineates the distal left main as well as the body very well. Whereas the previous view was showing it foreshortened. Here also you can see the cranial view is well delineating the distal LM as well as the bifurcation region, whereas the spider was showing it as foreshortened. So it means that it is not that spider view is the only view. No one view can show a particular RT very well, because every person's arteries are different. Next, I'll go to LAD. Usually, many operators give a test view. If we are an efficient technician, we can go with that as a lead. If not, then it is still okay. If the LCX comes below the LAD, initially from the AP view, then it is better to go to AP cranial, RAO cranial or AP cranial to get the LCX above the LAD. And if LCX come above, then AP cranial will lift it even further. Deep inspiration will even lift it further. That is the thing. In case if the LCX comes below, even in cranial, you can do one thing. Instead of doing in deep inspiration, further may overlap that further. So you can do the expiration and do that. But I would recommend this inspiration-expiration techniques we should avoid when we do interventions, because it will lead patients go into fatigue. So it's better not to use any inspiration or expiration. You better avoid doing inspiration-expiration and try to delineate the lesion very well. And RAO cranial position, if the LCX falls above, you can go a little more cranial or ask for inspiration to delineate the lesions. Once you see the lesion, you can modify the view by doing a bit more LAO to delineate that well. When it comes to LAD D1 orientation, it comes the same. If the LAD D1 comes above, then you can go little more cranial. It will still shift that diagonal further above. And to see the full course of the diagonal, it is better to do a AP cranial. It will show less overlapping with the LCX OMs, and you can see the full course of LAD diagonal. Steep LAO cranial also, many a times we can do it, but it will give increased radiation to us. Many of the operators nowadays don't prefer to do that. And then it is an inconvenient view for many of the operators. As we do in a radial procedures, we still do it with LAO cranial, but the leg side shield still prevents it from going into steeper views. And if you have a proximal overlap in LAD and diagonal, you can go into steeper RAO caudal or a spider view also to show that. But spider view, if the LAD and diagonal course is similar, then in spider view also you can have overlapping. So in those situations, it's better to do an RAO caudal. And in some scenarios, no caudal view will help us. Only cranial views helps us in those kind of situation where a very early originating diagonal, like Ramus kind of thing. And shallow LAO cranial and AP cranial also can show it very well. Steeper RAO caudal, as I said, when we have a very early diagonal. Here you can see a case where very early diagonal or Ramus kind of artery. which was absolutely abstracting the proximal origin, where the LED is at least about 10-15 millimeter well seen, where the spider is not showing that at all. It is like a very blunt stump immediately after the left main. Only the epicranial could delineate it. Even an areocranial was overlapping with this LCX. This next time, going to discuss about LCX. If LCX, as we discussed, it's all about the orientation. In a vertical heart, the overlap is very much in the proximal part of the heart. So when it's all about orientation between LED and LCX. If it is coming below, then you can just do a caudal. It will even stretch the proximal part very well. If it is coming above the LED, you should do more caudal or epicaudal, because to stretch the proximal part of the LCX, it is better to do spider or something, because in RAV view, whatever you stretch, if in a vertical heart, if the artery comes along in a parallel with the LED in AP view, then that means it is going to overlap in RAV or a shallow RAV. So you should do a spider or epicaudal. And to see the distal LCX, many a times you can see a lot of dominant LCX arteries where you want to see the distal lesion, which is not seen in any of the views. So where you can do areocranial, allocranial, or modify the cranial views according to your convenience. Many a times we do epicranial also. Here is a case where LCX is a very dominant, where the distal artery is having disease which we could not delineate in any other caudal views. You can see that, and the LAO, areocranial shows the distal distribution, but the bifurcation and other area is overlapping. The distal OM and the PDA bifurcation area is overlapping. Here you can see the distal OM is well opened, whereas the OM is distally overlapping. So if you see this modified AP view showing both the arteries with well delineated, well stretched out, and showing there is no significant lesion in that OM, whereas PDA is having tandem focal lesions. RCA, as we all do, other than the routine views, if you want to see proximal RCA, if it is tortuous or if it is having any overlap, you can do an LAO caudal or lateral view. To see the mid part also, in a lateral, if you can modify, you can modify into a bit of caudal view, because in lateral, doing a caudal cranial is a bit of a difficult thing. Caudal will disturb the patient's hand. Mid part and distal part is well seen in RAO and AP, and lateral and LAO cranial respectively. Here is a case where you can see that mid RCA and proximal RCA is having a lesion. As I said before, you can see that mid RCA is having a very eccentric lesion that is seen in RAO only, whereas LAO is not showing it, overlapping with the RV branch or an acute marginal, whatever you call it. Grafts generally LAD D1, wherever, whether it's bifurcation, like Y, Lima Rima Y, or separate graft also, AP. And LAO cranial and lateral, these two views will show us the anastomotic site very well. RAO cranial to see the distal runoff very well. The graft to LCX and OM is seen well in like routine our views in RAO caudal. LCX anastomotic part is well seen. LAO will show us the distal runoff as well as the proximal part of the graft very well. Graft to RCA, LAO cranial is to see the distal anastomotic part, and particularly proximal anastomotic part and distal anastomotic part is well seen in lateral view. RAO also shows very well of the total body of the graft, but still the anastomosis is well seen in the other two views. Here you can see some of the grafts. This is the OM graft. As I said, you see the whole body of the graft is well seen in LAO, whereas the distal runoff and anastomotic part of this early OM or RAMS is well seen in this view. Here you can see that a venous graft to LAD and then the Lima Rima Y into the OM and LAD part is well seen in iliocranial. Well, anastomosis, the anastomosis is well established in these two views. When it comes to coronary anomalies, you can see there are different type of LM anomalies we see. These are very rarely seen, but in RVO caudal is the view. Plain RVO is the view which shows us that what kind of LM we are dealing with. This intra-arterial is something which is very rarely seen because this is ischemic and it's fatal one, so mostly we don't see them. But retroaortic and anterior and septal fissure types we see rarely, yes. And I'll show some of the anomalies which we come across. Dextrocardia is something it is not very difficult to handle with. We just have to do opposite views. It is nothing that dextrocardia, it's a difficult thing. Even the catheters are same, and it is just that the views are opposite. Otherwise, it is not difficult. It is like you, instead of RVO caudal, you just do an LVO caudal. You do the spider, you do an RVO caudal. Epicranial, you do epicranial. In place of LVO cranial, you do RVO cranial. It is just the opposite view, mirror views. Even for RC also same thing. Instead of LAO, you do RAO here. Instead of RAO, you do LAO here. It's just opposite views in dextrocardia. And this is the LCX anomaly, the patient with large LAD and the big diagonal LCX is missing. Here you can see that there is a large LCX coming from the RCA. But if you see this, whatever may be the anomaly, the ostium is well seen in LAV view, whether it is from the left sinus or whether it is from the right sinus, whether it is from the non-coronary cusp or from above the cusps. This is well seen in LAV views. But the body and other parts are like routine views for any coronary artery, like LCX, LCX RAV caudal view, and the plain LAV or a spider view to see the proximal body. Here is another patient with an RCA, which is coming from the left side. Same as I said, like epicranial to see the distal part, and ostium and the proximal part is well seen in the LAV itself. This is another patient of RCA. This is another patient where we come across, like we have been searching for the arteries in the both right sinus, left sinus, but finally we found the arteries coming even just above the sinus, the single coronary ostium. So here you can see again same thing, like when we come to a epicranial, you see the LAD very well stretched out, and RCA is seen in LAO, and again epicranial shows the distal RCA very well. So, ostial orientation is well seen in LAO, and otherwise, you can see the distal body, distal part, and the body of the artery in routine views itself. So, when we do intervention, we choose views according to that which part of the body we are treating. Like in case, even if it is a single coronary ostium, it's better to take views for the respective arteries accordingly. This is another patient where we are seeing retrograde visualization of RCA. And you can see that LAO showing retrograde RCA coming there. And when we could not find the RCA multiple times, we have done an aortic root injection. Then we found there is nothing, there is retrogradely draining, but we can't find any blockage and it is not draining into aorta retrograde. If you see here in these two views clearly, you can see that the RCA is draining into another structure which is much anterior. Then we found it is an RCAPA. So other than these views, today with a good angiogram, the multiple other guided assessment also done, like angiographic TIMI, classification TIMI 1, 2, 3 flows, And then QCA is not in that way like in the past. Today it is well advanced, well calibrated. In fact, the measurements are more accurate than the olden days. And then still many of our labs, we use syntax core. And the way it is, the FFR is coming up, and the way the FFR is being developed, Siemens is already having tie-up with this angio-derived FFR. And that may be the future. So to have a very good angiogram is very important to get all this assessment proper, because the poor angiography can lead into wrong assessment of these procedures. And other than the above mentioned points, there are still some pitfalls like inadequate number of projections, because you think about contrast and think about number of projections. That is where you come as an efficient technician, which artery you are dealing with, which part you want to treat. Accordingly, you choose views, you minimize the number of views, but at the same time, delineate the artery very well. So if required in the initially, before procedure, to read the angiogram very well before the interventions, is better to have very good projections, very good number of views. And pulsatile injections, this is something we face with many of the beginners, and it is important to make sure you get very good injections. And like LCX anomalous arteries, many of us must have missed in a codominant RCA, catheter goes into Conner's branch and we find that is the artery. Many operators leaves it and then we find that is not an artery. They miss the RCA, miss the LCX from the left system. So super selective injection is something we should be careful about, and we should be helping the operators, particularly the beginners. And catheter induced spasm, as I said before, that is something we should be very careful about. We should be able to distinguish which is spasm, which is the lesion. So to avoid these things, as I said before, you can give vasodilators. And imaging during respiration, that is something which we avoid if possible. But if it is absolutely necessary, then we have to do that. To avoid these pulsatile injections, we can do injections, power injectors. Some of the centers in India also, they do it. Where RCA, you can do 5 to 6 ml with the 2 to 3 ml per second. And for LCA, 10 ml. 4 to 6 ml per second. Both the arteries, the PCA should not exceed 450. Many hospitals, they do 350 to 400 PSI. Using collimators is very important. That helps us to reduce the radiation. It helps us to give the quality imaging, and it helps us to improve less amount of artifact. Grid filters, this improves the image quality, but at the same time increases the radiation as well. But it is better to use to avoid, particularly to remove air artifacts. Many a times when the lung field comes in, the density between the heart and lung field causes air artifact towards the lung field. So it's better to put the grid filters on those areas. And above all, less movement. Many of the centers today, we use the 20 centimeter image intensifier field area, and some centers magnify further, which increases the radiation. But when you magnify more, you need to move the table. So to avoid that, more movement also causes blurring of image and poor image quality. To avoid that, see, many times when you move the table, you miss out the distal arteries or collateral supplies, which comes very late, or we don't know which one is the continuity of that artery. So it's better to have nominal 20 centimeter image intensifier magnification to avoid the less amount of movement. At the end, I would say that radiation safety is something we should be concerned about. To keep it as less as possible, particularly magnification, number of views, and less amount of abdomen, less area of exposure, less distance from the tube to the personnel, not to the patient, less distance from the tube to the personnel means us. Image intensifier to the patient distance should be as less as possible. Less steep angulations. I know we all like to do steep angulations, because as you see, the previous era, most of the books all speaks about 20 cranial, 20 caudal, but as we know today, those are useless views. We all do more steeper angulations to delineate because the intervention-based angiograms we do. So avoid steeper angulation if possible. And panning, as I said before. And more table height is important because it increases the distance between the patient and the patient and the tube. That reduces the amount of photoelectric effect and reduces the amount of radiation. And here I have given some dosage thing. This is from Morton J. Kern's interventional book, which shows that if RAO 30 to 60 degree gives one amount of radiation, the relative increase in LAO views is close to 3 to 6 times. And when it comes to lateral views, it is 9 times. Then you imagine, and definitely today we do very less number of lateral views because most centers we do radial procedures. So the lateral views less preferred, less used today, but still we should be knowing that it is something which causes nine times of the radiation. Though we use more safety apparels than the past, it's better to avoid having less amount of radiation. But at last, I would say that to have radiation safety, less amount of radiation, but we cannot compromise on the image quality, the goal must be achieved. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. N. Valasubramani. So you have to know the right projection to delineate the right artery with a minimum amount of dye. That's how you become a good technician. That was a wonderful phrase. It was an excellent lecture with case demonstration. So I would like to request our attendees, you can please type in your questions in the question answer box. But I would like to request first Professor MZ Azam to make some comments on this beautiful lecture.
Thank you, Tawfiq. Actually, wonderful presentation from the Balabu Rumani, right? Yes, I'm really impressed because you rightly pointed out good angiogram should need proper view first. Number two, you should consideration of the radiation hazards also. As you said very nicely, lateral view is the more radiation hazards and then allocranial. I think it is also important to remember it is also cause for high radiation dose. So during particular coronary angiogram, and if you want to really look a good view, you must go for the good angiogram first. At least one we push, give a dye 4 to 5 mL per second, suppose 10 mL, at least 3 cardiac cycles should be allowed to take the image. If you give the quick injection and quick view and come out, then it does not give a good view at all. So thank you very much. I think you will continue your work and you will join with us with the future events. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Professor Azam. I would now like to request Professor Dr. Amol Kumar Chaudhary to say a few words regarding this topic.
Tawfiq, and also the National Heart Foundation, Madam, to invite me as a chairperson, probably. I'd like to comment on the beautiful lecture from Balasubramaniam. We can omit the Bala Subramaniam from the Subramaniam lecture. It is very excellent and very simple to understand all the basic view of the during angiogram, and also he covered the anomalous origin as well as very nicely show the demonstration of CABG, particularly post graft angiography. First, I highlighted from my experience to share with the Subramaniam lecture. He nicely demonstrated all the things, but I like two things. The one view I always follow, the global assessment view. I think all of you know what is the global assessment view. Just after put a patient on the table and just puncture and femoral or radial, take a right left Judkin, and my instruction to my junior, take a global assessment view to avoid lot of catastrophe and frequent. Then subsequent view, what you direct the patient, what will be the direction of patient, what will be the next step to take, any step to take for the patient, or you will take any decision, that is global assessment view, that is AP STIP, new or AP STIP, whether you can take SINE or not. If you think no, it is not necessary, just I give a few ml dye and see the left main ostial, see the what the Balaji Subramaniam mentioned, that whether heart is horizontal or vertical, that means what is the relation between the LCX and LAD, whether we just instruct the patient deep inspiration or not, or rather than not to step and not to take any inspiration. Because what we see in left side AP STIP, we see the ostial, there is any severe ostial lesion is there or not, then the relation between LCX and LAD, whether it is the same position, overlap, whether LCX is down or whether LCX is up. If LCX is up, if you take instruct the patient, they take a deep inspiration, it is come, LCX come to the LAD and it is overlap. If it is overlap, then you, it is will act, then it's down during inspiration, LCX will come down. If it is already come down, already down to the LAD, no need to again instruct to patient to take deep inspiration. So global assessment view will avoid the severe spasm or severe osteoproximal lesion of the left main, and the relation of the LAD and LCX, which further detection of the, to the patient as well as also operator. Then we come to the calibration. I also keep a question to the madam and Badu Jaman bhai. It's a very senior to ask me. The calibration means there is a height of 6 feet 5 inch, gigantic figure. But sometimes we see some center, no sir, this is the rule, you must do the use of diagnostic catheter, particularly diagnostic, here is the rule, you must use 5. I think before this, I told that this patient, I did not visualize what the Subramaniam lecture showed. Pulse will be steaming, dye will be steaming, or pulsatile, or not vitalized, or underestimate of the lesion, or caliber also, reference caliber also, we did not get from this 5 French catheter in a 6.5 feet gigant foreigner. Also, some people of my country also, sometimes we got this type of gigantic figure where BMI is more than 35, height, weight is almost robust. So, I like to know whether is there any rule of the is there any rule to choose the diagnostic, particularly diagnostic catheter, in relation to height, weight, that means BMI. And another, I think, again, what the our Bangladesh technician and nurses, they, please use nitrate or any vasodilator in this simple angiogram, even then, if not contemplated, not intended to PCI also. Because in outside, we see that the one shot of 200 mics or more than 100 to 200 mics nitrate, give every patient after engaging the left or right, then take the supplementary or complementary view routinely. So that the our slogan is the for any intervention, good, very good angiographic view is paramount to do any decision for any good intervention, like simple lesion to start to CTU, because visualization of the collateral. And one thing I think Subramaniam mentioned, like the dominancy, what is the clinical importance of dominancy, what is dominancy, left dominancy is, or when we treat the left dominancy, how we take decision, or right dominancy is there, what is the surgical point of view of dominancy, it should be known to all the technicians and nurses, particularly technicians, to see the dominancy. Coronary intervention, the people we did, we know the dominancy, what is important. But there is, if patient on valvular heart disease came from surgery department, we know that the coronary artery will be normal. But dominancy is very important, because the dominancy of that artery will supply for mitral valve, all the valve apparatus is supplied from the dominant artery. If it is left dominant, that surgeon will be careful about the LCS handling or like things. If there is a valve replacement and CABG is 7 plus, even though not CABG, only valve replacement, they will take care the when the replace the valve or touch the mitral valve apparatus, there will be the dominancy, which side from this apparatus is supplied. It is also very important. So in summary,
to go to the next speaker, sir.
Sir, one the topic, one thing, the takeoff. The takeoff is does not detail mentioned by the Subramaniam. Very important though, both sides is takeoff. There is three type of takeoff: horizontal, inferior takeoff, and upward takeoff. This is very important for subsequent intervention to choose the guide catheter. Thank you. Thank you very much, Subramaniam, for nice lecture. Just I supplement few points. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So a very strong critic of PET angiogram is Professor M. Bachiruzzaman, sir. So if you would like to say a few words.
Thank you, Mr. Balasubramani. It was an excellent lecture. Very elaborate and very educative for all the technicians over there, also for us also. As I always said, if you cannot decide what to do after angiogram, then it's not an angiogram. Sometimes it happens, you come with a CD, the angiogram, you see the angiogram, and then you decide, you don't know what to do because there are a lot of things missing. So I always insist, probably I fight most with my technicians about the angiogram views. And as you have mentioned, the angiogram should clearly delineate the lumen. It should be full. The dye should be given in such a force and such a manner that all the vascular bed should be filled up with dye so that it is seen very clearly. And another thing is that take enough views. Sometimes people just hurry to finish the angiogram as fast as possible and they miss many things. So as we have mentioned, we have to take a lot of views. If you want to see them, a particular lesion, sometimes these ambiguous lesions, ambiguous branches, so we have to take a lot of views to decide what to do. And another thing that, as Dr. Amol has mentioned regarding the dominance, regarding the left dominance, you will never see the LPDA if you don't take allocranial views. Many people, they don't take allocranial views. Just they hurry and the patient have left dominant vessel and you cannot see the LPDA or PDA coming from the LCX. So I always insist that if the patient is of left dominance, please always take a allocranial view to see the clearly the LPDA, and always give enough amount of dye to fill the coronary arteries clearly, and so that the interventional cardiologist or even the surgeon can know what to do, where to put the graft, where to put the stent, what is the stent extent of the lesion. So the main thing is that good angiogram is the angiogram which can lead us to take the correct decision. Thank you very much.
So that was a wonderful lecture. Thank you so much. That was really wonderful. Just one word of caution to our junior technicians is that sometimes they do get carried away. They do want to take good pictures, and what they do in a patient with poor ejection fraction, in a patient with chronic kidney disease, you know, be smart in your thinking and know what you want to see. Sometimes some young technicians get carried away along with a young operator maybe and go on taking lots of views in a patient with very poor ejection fraction or in a patient with CKD. So think, have a game plan and do the angiogram. And another thing about angiograms, I think a very exciting thing that has come up, and that is angio co-registration with OCT. So now with OCT, if we can do angio co-registration without any extra dye while we're taking the angiogram, we can have a good look inside the lumen of the artery. Also in those cath labs where OCT along with angio co-registration is. So that's another new exciting thing that will be maybe a part of cath labs in the future. But thank you. That was a fantastic lecture and I really enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
So thank you, Mr. Balasubramani. Thank you, madam. We would now like to go move on to our next speaker, Mrs. Maria Sultana Lippi, our senior staff nurse and cath lab in charge. She has been with us for a very long time, taking care of our cath lab. And we always go to her, not only to ask if my patient is ready or if my patient is on the table. We also go to her for every small thing we need. If you have torn your cloth, if you have lost your cell phone, even if you're hungry, you go to Lippi and say, Lippi, I'm in trouble, please help me out. So this is our Maria Sultana Lippi. She will be delivering her lecture on sterilization and asepsis in cath lab, responsibility of cath lab nursing staff.
Honorable Chairperson, respected expert panelists, moderator, parents, friends, and colleagues. I am Maria Sultana Lippi, working at National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute. Today, my topics, sterilization and asepsis in cath lab, responsibilities of the nursing staff. What is sterilization? A physical or chemical process that destroys or removes all microbial life, including spores. Disinfection. It is killing or removing or harmful microorganisms. Antiseptic. A product that destroys or inhibits the growth of microorganisms in or on living tissue. Aseptic. Characteristic by the absence of pathogenic microbes. Method of sterilization. There are three methods of sterilization. Mechanical method, physical method, chemical method. Physical method, heat, dry heat, moist heat, radiation, non-ionic radiation, ionic radiation, filtration, depth filter, membrane filter, air filter. Material-based sterilization method. Inoculating wires or loops can sterilize by red heat. Gloves product can sterilize by hot air oven. Apron, gloves, gown, dressing, or other clothing can sterilize by autoclave. Sharp instrument can sterilize by crystal 5%. All type of catheter, balloon, and reusable item we can sterilize by ETO. Sometimes we can sterilize by with Cydexar. It should be at least 30 minutes duration. Cydex should be changed every 14 days. Any item when withdrawn from Cydex should be cleaned properly with sterile water. Operation theater and cath lab can sterilize by fumigate and ultraviolet rays. How to fumigate cath lab? 2 HTML formalin plus 150 gram potassium permanganate, we can sterilize 1000 square feet of area. How and why we should maintain sterilization in the cath lab? Proper sterile technique has the potential to decrease the patient infection rate. Hand washing remaining the most important part before starting procedure for preventing infection. Cap, mask, gown, and gloves help to protect the patient by maintaining a sterile field. Protection of personnel by proper gowning, gloving, and eyewear. Disposal of contaminated equipment. Care of puncture wounds and lacerations. To prevent infection from bloodborne pathogens, the standard universal precaution is essential in the cath lab and throughout the hospital. All personnel should strongly consider vaccination for hepatitis B virus. Principle of sterile technique. Aseptic and sterile technique based on some scientific principle are carried out primarily to prevent transmission of microorganisms that causes infection. To prevent infection, all possible measures are taken to create and maintain a therapeutic environment for the patient. careful attention to the creation and maintenance of a safe and therapeutic environment is mandatory. 10 principle from optimal level of septic practice. Only sterile items are used within the sterile field. Sterile persons are gowned and gloved. Tables are considered sterile only at table level. Sterile person touches only sterile item or areas. Unsterile person only touches only unsterile item or areas. Unsterile person avoid dressing over the sterile field. Sterile person avoid cleaning over unsterile field. Age of sterile container are not considered sterile once the package has been opened. Sterile field is kept as close as possible to the time of use. Sterile area are continuously kept in view. Sterile person keep well within the sterile area. Sterile person keep contact with the sterile field. Aseptic technique. Pathogens, hand washing and universal precaution, method of sterilization and disinfection, sterile table setup, maintenance and percutaneous access with sterile draping. Universal precaution. Hand hygiene, gloves, facial protection, gown, patient care equipment, linen. Hand scarf and gloves. Hand washing is the single most important procedure for preventing nosocomial infection. An operator should start the day in the laboratory with a hand scarf of at least 2 or 3 minutes. Utilizing a sterile surgical scarf, brush socket with detergent, and a topical antiseptic agent that has a persistent chemical effect. 2 types of agent are commonly used for hand washing, plain soap and antiseptic. Proper user technique of gloves. Gloves should be put on in a sterile manner. They should be changed if a puncture occurs or blood is detected under the gloves during the procedure. Surgical hand antiseptics using either an antimicrobial soap or an alcohol-based hand rub with persistent activity is recommended before doing sterile gloves. Before applying the alcohol solution, pre-wash hand and forearm with a non-antimicrobial soap and dry completely. After application of the alcohol-based product, allow hand to dry thoroughly before doing sterile gloves. Dress. Non-prop dress should be used to cover the area surrounding field. Maximum sterile barrier precaution should be utilized during catheter insertion. The sterile sheet should be large enough to cover the entire patient. And any other hardware attached to the table that could come in contact with long catheter or wires. Any adhesive material attached to the skin around the wound and to the drapes should be isolated the wound site from the surrounding unprepared skin. Use surgical drape that remaining effect barrier when wet. Proper aseptic technique including the use of cap, mask, sterile gown, sterile gloves and a large sterile sheet for the insertion of central venous. Cleaning. The catheter should be completely cleaned once a day and pot clean between each case. The floor should be wet mop or wiped with brush. Pilus is evident. Trust should be removed between each case. Center for Disease Control recommendation. After the last catheterization procedure of the day or night, wet vacuum or mop The cath lab flowed with a single mop and an EPA resistor hospital disinfectant. Example of the cath lab workflow map. Cath lab schedule patient, patient checking, patient PPR, patient arrival to the cath lab, physician arrival to the cath lab. Procedure start, procedure perform, case complete, nursing sign out, patient leave from cath lab, and properly clean cath lab for next case. Aseptic precaution. GLAD contaminated drapes, gown, gloves, and sponges should be discarded in a special container and labeled as healthcare waste. Needle and blade should be placed in puncture-proof container. Fixed and disposable cath lab equipment. Single-use disposable catheters are the current standard for the majority of equipment utilized in the catheterization lab. Standard techniques should be employed to ensure proper sterilization of equipment that is reused. Reuse of equipment should be limited to only the currently permitted by federal regulations. Use of antibiotic. Antimicrobial drug prophylaxis is not routinely recommended for cath lab procedure. Antibiotic prophylaxis should be considered for the immunocompromised patient and for any patient with problem or defined wound contaminated during the procedure. If an antibiotic is used prophylactically, cephalosporin or cefazolin, which as activity agent common skin organism should be used. A single dose of parenteral antimicrobial is needed within 30 minutes of device insertion, like in PPM, valvular disease, and device closure cases. Catheterization technique. Prolonged procedure and labs is aseptic technique are important causes of wound infection. Care should be taken to prevent large hematoma, which serve as needles for infection. Fever is a relative contraindication for an elective cardiac catheterization. Initially, this patient was angiogram and PCI, another hospital, in 3 months back. After that, patient developed infective endocarditis. CT scan plus coronary angiogram found coronary artery aneurysm. Coil embolus in my hospital successfully treated with embolic microcoil for coronary aneurysm followed by IV antibiotic for carditis. High risk patient, the potential for acquired disease from bloodborne pathogen excites for all invasive procedure. It should be assumed that every patient has the potential to transmit an infection agent. So it is important to apply universal precaution throughout the hospital as well as in the cath lab. However, some patients referred for cardiac catheterization lab will be known to carry HIV or the hepatitis virus. If universal precautions are followed, there is no reason such patient should be managed differently, since the hand of the operator are most likely to come in contact with blood. Some operators choose two pairs of gloves. Management of emergency. During emergency cases like primary PCI, we do not know the patient history of bloodborne disease. In that time, we should follow universal precaution technique. emergency managed in the cath lab. Temporary pacemaker was placed, primary PCI was started with the guiding catheter, and found left system was totally occluded with thrombus, including left main. Heart was rarely moving. Quickly wired and thrombus aspiration done. After aspiration done, intracorporeal adrenaline given, then the heartbeat beating. Patient cardiac arrest, CPR was going on. Patient developed respiratory arrest and immediate intubation done. Flow was established after stenting with intracoronary adenosine, GTN, and adrenaline, but DP was undetectable. So patient was in cardiogenic shock. Intra-aortic balloon pump given at working. Final angiogram show left main to LCX but early vascular structure with good flow. Patient was shifted to CCU with other medication. This type of cases was needed to take extra precaution to prevent infection because patient is in ventilator and IVP supported. 7 days later, patient was discharged from hospital. 4 months later, second GO show LCX RC is non-dominant vessel but good collaterals to LAD. Left pit to LCX or well revascularized and large volume occluded. LAD is also totally occluded from proximal part. Patient underwent CABG and at present he is symptom free. In this case, cath lab nurses need to take some responsibilities. When emergency medical officer informed cath lab about this case, we are ready. A scrub trolley with PCI kits, anesthetic equipment, cast trolley and defibrillator, infusion pump, IABP, TPM patching wire, emergency medication, atropine, adrenaline, dopamine, etc. Take home messages. Sterilization and disinfection is an important part of successful outcome of any cath lab procedure. Cath lab nurses has to be vigilant to maintain an aseptic environment. Always should be alert regarding maintaining step of asepsis among all cath lab users. Periodic inspection to ensure a clean workplace is essential. Recognize the importance of theoretical and practical concepts among nurses and junior staff and arrange regular meeting and training. Maintain a good relationship with all members within the cath lab. Take active part in departmental meeting and recognize positive participation from all staff in cath lab. Keep up to date knowledge. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lipi. That was a beautiful lecture describing how we should maintain asepsis in the cath lab. So I would like to so what is the chemical that is used in the Cydex jar? That is the question. That is one of the questions. So you have already said it is glutaraldehyde, right?
Yes, glutaraldehyde. 2%. Cydex 2%.
So can you tell us a few things about what do we do extra during this COVID time for our safety? What do you want to ensure?
I prefer PPE wire.
For the patients, they have to come with their COVID report.
COVID-19, yes sir. COVID-19 test must negative.
And for the operators?
And operators the are PPE and IOIR. and the gloves, and then ice light, man, face light, light.
Face shoot, right?
Yeah, shoot. Yeah, put it.
Right. At the same time, we also do not gather too many patients in the cath lab or in the hemostasis area.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
So I would like to request Professor Badu Zaman sir to say a few words on this lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Taufik. Thank you, Lipi. It was an excellent lecture from you. Because actually, it's, nurses have a very important play to role in the cath lab. Because to maintain the aseptic environment is very essential to have a good result. Plus, the vigilance of the nurses during emergency is also very important. As we all know, this part of the world, we reuse many hardwares like catheters, wires, balloons. So our method is different from other developed world, European, American. So we need to ensure the sterilization process of this reuse material very meticulously so that we don't induce an infection in the patient during the procedure. And regarding the disposal of the infectious material, actually, I think we should be very meticulous also in disposing the different items in different, as you have shown in the different baskets, different colored of waste paper box. So I think it's very essential. We have to maintain this regularly. Asepsis, I think, on the nurse's point of view, asepsis is the most important part in our cath lab of our country. Because we are using many hardwares repeatedly. And regarding the vigilance, I have already said, you have to be very vigilant. It was a wonderful lecture. I think nurses have learned a lot from the lecture, and I hope we'll be continuing this education again. Thank
you. Professor Dr. Amol Kumar Choudhury, sir, a few words from you.
Thank you, Lipi, for very time-worthy, as well as a very important part of cath lab. In the context of like our country, where there is a very important role of sterilization, and that is played by principally by cath lab nurse, and she mentioned all the step and all the procedure and all the categories of sterilization. I would like to only one thing though: who are the entitled to stay cath lab in routine and as well as emergency? If there is no code system, blue code or red code like this, there is only principal operator is in a sterile position, himself and as well as sterile area, then fellow, or if no need, there is no scope of fellow, second operator, then one scrub nurse, one circulatory nurse. That circulatory nurse is not in full sterile. She wear a lead apron, but circulate the things which is not available in this cat and can bring it from another cat or store and wear only lead and also mask and not fully gowned. So it keep in mind there is a role of circulatory nurse is very important to play a role. And one is radiologist to operate the fluoroscopy machine and one cath lab technician. If there is any imaging, coronary imaging, or any hemodynamics is going inside, like power injector is going under use or like this. Otherwise, cath lab technician is also in control room. Only operator of the fluoroscopy. Thank you. Thank you for nice.
Thank you, sir. Professor M.G. Azam, would you like to add something?
Thank you, Taufik. Thank you, Maria, for your smart presentation. And as you know, cath lab activities are really teamwork, and the chief consultant or operator is the number one person, and number two person is the cath lab sister who is the in charge. And she makes the bridge between consultant and radiographer as well as other members. And he or she play major role, and it is the ideal when you make a list for cath lab procedure, at least if it is due to outpatient selection, you can do it within 30 days according to SCAI recommendation. And if you go for inpatient department patient, at least you go for 24 hours before the procedure, you should evaluate the patient properly. Then you make a list and send it to the cath lab sisters, and she should understand what is the background clinical diagnosis and what procedure should be is planned. That's accordingly, she can plan his cath lab team and he prepare his table and necessary action he can take. So I think in most of our cath labs doing right way, but thing is that in our country like Bangladesh, especially government hospitals or semi-government hospitals are very much infection prone. Especially in the last year, we had a lot of aneurysmal case, most likely due to post-infections. So now we can overcome it by our meticulous approach from the top to bottom list. Then I hope we will cover, if we give the attention in from entry point to exit point, then we can reduce our infection rate. So thank you very much. And I must give Heart Foundation, as well as Fazila Madam, take the leadership quality, because to enrich our, not only doctors, as well as our sisters and technicians, because they are the integral part of our total management systems. If I develop myself, if I don't give importance to our colleagues, so we don't achieve our total goal. So thank you very much again.
Yes, I forgot to mention one thing. Lipi was an invited faculty in EuroPCR 2 years back. There also she delivered a beautiful lecture. So, Mr. Balasubramani, I would like to ask a few words. What extra things you are doing for protection during this COVID era? If you want to say for 1 or 2 minutes.
Yes. COVID actually, initially we were had 3 labs, but currently we are having only 2 functional labs. So we segregated labs. One lab is completely for patients who are elective and tested with RT-PCR, negative patients. The other lab is for the patients who are coming for emergencies and like primary PCI or temporary pacing, which needs to be fluoroscopically screened. That lab, we are keeping it for suspected as well as some positive patients where we have to do, like we had done a patient with complete R block, permanent pacing was to be put on where COVID was positive. So, but he was asymptomatic for COVID, but when we did a temporary, we did with the PP, like any patient walks in for a primary PCI or temporary, we do with the PPE, irrespective of CT showing suspicion or not suspicious, whatever. It goes with the PPE. Like after the procedure, sometimes if the gene expert, RT-PCR also goes, gene expert also goes. If the gene expert comes negative, patient stays in the building. Yeah, otherwise, it goes into the other building which has COVID patients. So we have a separate building for COVID patients. After the primary, after the temporary, if the patient comes out to be gene expert positive or RT-PCR is still not available or gene expert is not done, when the gene expert was not available, we used to send the patient to the COVID building till the time there is a suspect area and the confirmed area in the COVID building as well. So once the RT-PCR report is available, patient comes back to the main building. Otherwise, the patient stays in the COVID building itself. So okay, that's where we go. Patient is suspected as patient. So if the report is there, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Balasubramani. Madam, before we move on to the final lecture, a few words from you, please.
Thank you. I think we should move on to the third lecture as you are all looking forward to that. Just one word is that during this COVID era, we've really minimized the number of personals working in the cath lab. That is also a very important precaution that we take. Nowadays, we all do PCIs, one doctor, one nurse, one technician. Usually, it's just 3 persons working in the lab nowadays for all of us. So that is another thing. To safeguard our personnel, we have lowered the number of doctors, technicians, and nurses working each day just to safeguard ourselves.
We actually keep one circulating nurse also inside, ma'am, even if it is a COVID positive patient. And we keep a PPE worn, one more technician nurse ready outside the cath lab if necessary to rush in, otherwise, because once the emergency happens, you cannot have a PPE wearing time. So PPE worn, because two more PPEs are used because to exchange hardwares and handling files. So the person who is outside also, two people put on PPEs, and one more ward boy also kept on PPE, like assistants, patient assistants. So two nurses, one doctor, one technician is the way we work in.
So ma'am, I'll move on to the last speaker.
Yes, please.
Yes. So our last speaker is Mr. Murshiduddin. He is our chief cath lab technician. And since the day I started working in this cath lab, I have seen him working relentlessly. His strength lies not only to read the complex cases and preparing himself and the hardwares accordingly, but also by of being very friendly with the juniors and very supportive to the seniors. So he has been an invited speaker for Euro-PCR, Asia-PCR, and many other conferences. And today he will be speaking on preparation for complex PCI on technician's perspective. Mr. Murshiduddin, please.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So, honorable chairperson, respected panel expert, my teacher, moderator, friends and colleagues. Assalamu alaikum. I am Mohammad Murshiduddin, working at National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute as a chief cath lab technician. Today, I would like to share some preparation for the complex PCI on technician perspective only. So in the cardiovascular cath lab, a cardiologist works with a multidisciplinary team of assistants to diagnose and treat life-threatening heart disease. This team is usually comprised of senior consultants, assistant doctor, nurses, and technicians, and other paramedical assistants. We all know that procedure success and long-term outcome depends on good teamwork and experienced interventional cardiologists and utilization of specialized equipment. So technician duty started from early in the morning. When he enters in the cath lab, he should hear about the temperature of the cath lab machine and what is the humidity of the cath lab control room and cabinet room before switching the machine. Before patient in the cath lab, he should check all the life-saving devices and instruments like the procedural table, sterile equipments, defibrillator, TPM generator and lead, oxygen, Sarkar machine, intubation set, and other emergency medicine, and all the image modalities are in the cath lab. The term of complex refer to a large number of things together, especially when they are difficult or confusing. In complex PCI, clinical outcomes following invasive revascularization depends on patient characteristics, cardiac function, coronary artery distribution, and the number of disease vessel involvement. As a team member in the cath lab, we should know how to use proper tools in proper position. May participate to take proper decision in the cath lab during complex situations, determine the complexity and prepared as how to overcome safely and safety wise. During tackling complex lesion, necessary tools are very important, like DES, IBUS, OCT, FFR, various type of hydrophilic and non-hydrophilic guide wires, various type of balloon, distal protection device, mother and child, root ablation, cutting balloon, etc. An integrated approach combining those devices with specialized technique and adjunctive pharmacological agent has greatly improved PCI success rate and for those complex lesions. We should know the imaging during tackling complex PCI. We should be clear concept of different modalities of coronary imaging as well as the advantages and limitations. Be aware of the limitations of coronary angiography and how to intracoronary imaging can be used to overcome them. Ability to use intracoronary imaging when required and maintained should be properly. It is very essential for the immediate and long-term outcome and assessment of the coronary intervention, even research purpose also. When tackling this type of case in the cath lab, severe left main stenosis involving the origin of LAD as well as a left dominant circumflex vessel, we need to take preparation before starting the procedure. Reviewing the CD properly with the senior consultant and need to take proper decision what type of catheter should be taken for those cases and what type of wire and balloon should be kept for the ready and what type of bifurcation technical stenting we are using. Yes, we should prepare. And imaging tools should be prepared before starting the procedure. When using double stent strategy in bifurcation lesion, final kissing should be performed with the proper technique. Finally, report should be performed before the bifurcation portion with the higher size balloon but shorter length. We did OCT in this case and found that all the vessels are nicely visualized as well as 3D navigation grip found that stent is nicely apposed within the vessel and nicely accessed with the side branch. So during using OCT, we should know how to manipulate the ECT, how to interpret the OCT images and how to maintain OCT catheter for the next time users. We should know limitation of angiography. Already Balasubramanian defined that many angiographically significant lesions are not physiologically significant. In that time, like this type of cases, when perform angiography in the cath lab, we need to evaluate properly. It is coronary catheter induced spasm or severe stenosis in the left main. So need to take proper catheter for the intracoronary GTN should be given. And we have found that the disappeared catheter induced spasm should be proper assessment. We did FFR in this case and found that there is no gradient left main to LAD. So this patient is treated by the medical treatment. So if we see the guidelines, FRAME study showed FFR guided PCI is better than the angio guided PCI in treating during complex cases. I would like to share this typical case, only 29 years old, doctor by profession. He was admitted with the non-STEMI. However, ejection fraction was normal. This hospital angiography performed and found left main and LAD lesion are ambiguous. We know that stenting those lesion could result in over-treatment and worsening outcome. So in that time, this team treated this patient with the 3 into 36 millimeter DES from left main to LAD without further any imaging modality or imaging other in evaluation. Maybe some emergency RIs, that why they are put at the stent. However, a stent deployed within the vessel, not isolation, need to properly assess angiographic views with the team member and strategize. So this patient, within the 6 months, he developed chest pain. And check CG found left main ostium is severely stenosis, ISF, circumflex is dominant vessel, which is severely stenosis at its origin. After that, heart team decision now tackle with the CABG. So surgeon put a graft in lima to LAD and secretion graft SBG to diagonal and OM branches. Very unfortunate, 14 months later, patient developed again chest pain and diagnosed as non-STMI with LVF. Patient was hospitalized and controlled LVF and check CG found. Severe stenosis proximal as well as distal anastomotic site. Lima to LAD grafts also severely stenosis distal anastomotic site. Now need to tackle this case again, re-PCI. So what we learned from this case stent is a life-saving device. However, it is very harmful if not properly utilized. When required, the stent should be always a proper size and proper position. Orthogonal views are mandatory to proper positioning stent. And when using long stent in left main to LAD or LCX, should be performed proximal optimization with the higher size balloon. However, no need to tackling with the PCI. We managed to cannulate the catheter and left ventricular subcomplex wire and predilatation done with the 3.5 9mm NC balloon. After that, perform IVUS and showed very grossly undersized stent within the lumen and grossly malabsorbed. So, aggressive instant dilatation done with the 4 into 9mm NC balloon at 22 atmospheric pressure. After that, LAD CTO, which is ISR occurred, it is open with the CT wire supported with the microcatheter and tip injection found mid to distal LAD is also diseased. So gentle balloon dilatation done with the proximal to mid LAD. After that, left ventricular LCX stent put it with 4.5 into 22 millimeter DS. And final kissing balloon dilatation done with left main to LAD with the DEB 3.5 into 25 millimeter and NC balloon 4.5 into 10 millimeter left main to LCX. So final kissing is mandatory when use double stent strategy. Actually, this patient is modified double stent strategy before put. So always do port and report as required. Imaging is very helpful in double stent during technique use. We use double stent, imaging IVUS and found vessel is nicely revascularized, stent is nicely approached within the lumen. So this procedure was done in 2012. This still now this patient is going well and he is under supervision. He is regularly follow up. This is the another case, very elderly patient who the CABG was done 15 years back and 5 years back PCI done. His ejection fraction was only 35%. So if we see the angiography, need to evaluate left main lesion and LAD is totally occluded before stent portion. Lima is totally occluded. RC is dominant vessel, which is also occluded, filled by ipsae and contralateral collaterals. And so when we face this type of cases, only lifeline is circumflex, which is peristent dystenosis also in OM. So before starting the procedure, we need to strategize the options. So staging is the option of this type of cases. Need to decide that which vessel treat first, left or right. So team decision. Need to tackle left side first and wire left main to LAD wire with the CT wire, and CT wire should be removed from LAD for further events prevent. After that, we found from IBUS for the evaluation left main and found that it's gross, very significant flag button in the left main, but LCS ostium is free of disease. So after predilatation, mid LAD is treated first with the long stent. Now, need to tackle first peristent dystenosis in OM, because if we put stent left main to LAD, maybe another events or maybe any complicity arise with these cases during delivering the stent in the OM. So sometimes operator concentrated with the case, we should request our operator very gently. It is very important things when we offer something our operator, professor, should be very politely, gently, and try to analyze why you talking this type of these tips. And never be panic, the operator. So we tackle peristent dystenosis. After that, post-stent in Lakmin 12AD. And after post-dilatation, IBUS study showed Lakmin 12AD and LCX is nicely visualized. Stent is also opposed. So in need to tackle sometimes ACS in graft vessel PCI. Never hesitate to put distal protection device if you have to prevent the distal embolization. Sometimes we are facing this type of cases, very tortuous, angulated, and highly calcified small caliber vessel. In that time, stent delivery is the major problem. So we can apply the mother and child catheter in this situation for the delivering stent. I would like to share the final, the very complex case. This patient also see visuals done 2 years back. All the grafts are occluded and now need to tackle this case with the PCI. So before starting the case, we need to assess very carefully and analytically. Is this actually, this case was done in our hospital, live case from our hospital to abroad. We are done by Professor Fozil Malik Mann. So that's why we put temporary pacemaker in that time. So before starting the procedure, we should check Ruta component. It is all the Ruta component are available and it is working position. So we are using in our lab Ruta cocktail. It's a homemade 1000 ml saline bag consists with the 5 mg barophenylated adenosine and 1000 mics of nitroglycerin, 5000 units of heparin, and we consist on ampoule of adrenaline for preventing thrombus formation, vascular spasm, avoiding no-flow phenomena, and prevention of hypotension. So sometimes require multiple, but in that time we need to proper concept how to attach and detach the bar with the advancer and should be carefully maintained. So after root ablation, lesion should be properly prepared before putting stent. And during putting stent, orthogonal views are very important for the positioning. So we are covering the from ostium to LAD, 4x34 mm stent. After that, port should be performed with the higher size and shorter balloon. And IBA study showed vessel is nicely revascularized and stent also nicely opposed. We never forget, during treating complex case, we are using radiation. So in the cath lab technician should have to basic knowledge of radiation physics and terminology, radiation risks and protection modalities. What is needed for radiation safety, method of control exposure, how to minimize exposure to radiation. Maintains properly X-ray equipment and safety components in the cath lab should be aware and properly used during the procedure in the cath lab. This is the vital role of responsibility of the cath lab technician after procedure. He should groin compression, properly access such compression. So inventory is the very important thing for the smooth running of the department. So encouraging, maintain a good relationship within the member, within the cath lab, all the member within the cath lab. So if I want to be an efficient cath lab technician, need to achieve some qualities. Have to demonstrate professional expertise, has an intuitive grasp of each situation and identify the problem without time delay. From a deep understanding of the total situation, performance should become fluid, flexible, and highly proficient. Acquire the theoretical knowledge and practical skill to assist in all procedures in the cath lab. Assist in pre-procedural, peri-procedural, and post-procedural patient care and management. Identify the optimal strategy to assist in managing procedural related complications. Circulate during the procedure, being responsible for the patient well-being, assisting and observing vital signs and hemodynamic monitoring during the procedure. After a procedure, observing for complications, perform access site compression and giving a proper handover to the transferring ward. maintain privacy, dignity, and confidentiality, ensuring patient safety at all times. Promote effective communication within the team members. Deliver evidence-based practice. After the completion of the all procedure, technicians should be aware all the device, all the devices are off, should be switched off properly and cleaned properly. After that, he should off the log the lab. I am very much grateful and introduced as a cath lab member in the National Heart Foundation Hospital. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Morshed. That was an excellent lecture, very case-based discussion. Both of our technicians today spent a good amount of slides to tell us about the hazards of radiation. But I doubt when we are doing complex cases and the adrenaline surge is high, how much we care about the radiation of on which the operators are mainly exposed. So we should also take care of that thing. So I would like to request Professor M.G. Azam to say a few words. Before we conclude.
Because now we are in the end of the, about to end of the session, and as well, Murshid presentation I already observed, and TCT also. He present his all case very brilliantly, and we must appreciate his presentation and smart explanation along the question answer session, especially I was there in TCT, I was witness there. Thank you, Murshid. Your case-based discussion is really, I think it is encouraging for our upcoming technicians who are really encouraged. And I always promote them. I am always insist them, please present your case, present your case. And especially in our NACBT, because you know NACBT technicians are some extent lag behind from their presentation or active participation in case of cath lab activities in the home and abroad as well. So I must today, it's my promise to gear up my institute personnel to make sure their participation in the next meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Azam. Thank you very much for your appreciation. Professor Amol Kumar Choudhury, sir, I have a concluding remarks from you.
Thank you, Murshid, for presenting your different, very complex PCI, not complex, very complex PCI.
Thank you, sir.
I think principal operator, most of the cases, I think Lipman related, I think he should be done by Madam Fazilatul Malik, Madam.
Right, sir.
Encouragement, I should appreciate the technician should how to present at least to see one or slide and what are the role behind this. Just a summary of the role behind this case in the technician as a role of technician, what he or she or he, I think explore like you. We also, as I already said, that our technician is lag behind. So we also see your capability and presentation, and we also try to encourage our technician how to present the case and deal the very critical case. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Professor M. Bodhiuzaman, sir, concluding remarks from you kindly.
Thank you, Murshid, for your brilliant presentation. It was a good presentation for us and encouraging also, definitely, all the complex cases you have done with the operators. And definitely, we all know that every operator feel very comfortable doing case with you because you made us our job very easy by your all the good choices. You know, you made the choice, good choices in advance. So we feel very, very, very comfortable being complex PCI with Murshid. Thank you, Murshid, for your excellent presentation. And I don't want to get too much because it's already too late. I think Professor Fazilat Malik, she will be talking a few words to conclude the session. Thank you.
Yes, madam. Kindly, your concluding remarks.
Well, first of all, I think this was a very enjoyable and educative session for all of us. This I have to say. And initially, we were seeing, you know, not too many participants, but I was observing at one time we had 120 participants. So congratulations. We had a good crowd and all three speakers were absolutely brilliant. I really enjoyed and learned so much from all of you, and especially for our guest speakers. Thank you so much for coming. You know, well, you didn't come, you came virtually, but we look forward to the day when you come physically here and do some work with us when the COVID goes. And Moshe, Lipi, they're always great. You know, one thing I have to tell you, like they're, everyone in our CAT Lab is like a family to us. And that's the secret, I think, why we all enjoy our work so much. Another clarification I have to say is that I don't do all the left main. For some reason, you think that is, but everyone like Professor Bodhuzaman does a lot of left main, Professor Nazir and all the associate professors like Osho, Khabib, Taufik, everyone does left main in our hospital. I do a bit more maybe because I'm really interested in this, but everyone is very competent about, and the one of the reasons is because the teamwork is so superb. That is the reason that we do complex cases. And as Professor Bodhuzaman pointed out, that with Moshe, it's a piece of cake because he will take care of all the wires. All the wires will be there. All the pre-dilatation, post-dilatation balloons will be there. If it's an OCT catheter, the catheter will be there. So, you know, a technician can make your life so easy. And that is something that we really appreciate about Moshe and also about Lipi, because when Lipi assists you, she will know what we don't have to speak. Like a primary PCI, one day I came out of the primary PCI, Lipi and I had not spoken a word. She knew what I wanted, I knew what she would be giving me. So this kind of teamwork, you know, this makes life a lot easier. And thank you for again teaching us what an important role technicians and nurses have in our teamwork. Thank you. I really enjoyed the session. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you very much, our expert panelists, for giving your valuable time for this session and encouraging our technicians and nurses, those who have joined us. I'm sure all of them have learned a lot. So with permission from the panel and madam, may I conclude this session?
Thank you.
Okay. Goodbye. We see you next Wednesday with another lecture for the students on atrial septal defect. Thank you.
And thank you, our guests, for coming. Thank you.
Again.
Thank you. I love it. Thank you.